What an amazing episode, full of wonderful memories for all of us. But it's not over yet. Let me take you back over 12 years of wonderful memories. November 1981, Malcolm Fraser was Prime Minister of Australia. Ronald Reagan was the American President. In London, a newlywed Princess Diana switched on the Christmas lights. In Australia, Dennis Lilly created a sensation with this unsportsmanlike conduct.
The number one song was Physical by Olivia Newton-John. Flying High and Apocalypse Now were the summer movie hits. And Kim Wilson was just 8 years old. As Australians enjoyed a warm summer day, a daring new television series was launched on the Seven Network.
Oh, had to get my head cleared this morning. General, you're looking in good shape.
I saw the pilot script and thought, this actually, I think this probably could have legs. I thought to myself, I think this could go for a good 18 months. I think we're quite happy to there for 18 months. I thought, other people said, I don't know, because the kinds of soaps and things that were going out at the time were pretty lurid melodramas. And this was harkening back to Bell World and that sort of quiet, home country kind of thing, which really wasn't the fashion.
Hello, Cheryl.
Oh, hi, Frank. Sorry, I haven't got time to talk.
Can I give you a hand with something there?
No, that's okay.
Yeah, I can carry this for you.
Oh.
You like a drop of wine, do you?
I never drink when I'm drinking. Driving. I mean, I never drive I don't touch it. Vicky's the one.
Well, I had a feeling that if they let it on, stay on for 6 months, the public would fall in love with it. So it was really a case of whether the stations would keep it on long enough for it to grab the public. Because when I read the first script, what I really liked about it was that there was nothing else like it at that time. We'd come out of a whole spate of homicides and cops and robbers, and there hadn't been a show dealing with social issues around at that time. In other words, there hadn't been a responsible series, because To Me a Country Practice was a series, not a soap, because it came to a conclusion each week. And there hadn't been anything like that ever before. And I thought, well, leave it there long enough and let the public decide.
Now, how about dinner, just between friends?
I think it'd be very hard just to remain friends with you, Dr. Barrett.
I remember saying to Jim Davin after the pilot, and he said, if it goes ahead, how long will you stay? And I said, James, look, I can only see myself doing this for a few months. You know, that's about it. And James was saying, please, give us a year, give us a year. And, of course, 3.5 years later...
You're still there.
We're still there.
And last it did, 12 years. And over those 12 years, many well-known faces have passed through Wandon Valley. Here are just a few.
Mr. Burton Locke?
I do. My friends call me Cookie.
Okay.
And
Mr. Bob Happy?
Mr. McKenzie.
McKenzie? Oh, yeah. G'day, mate.
Yeah.
I would like to settle down here in Wandon Valley with you, with me. Vernon Jr.
What position are you trying out for?
Second base. Me too.
You serving at the bar, Sonny, or at the pull up yourself?
Da 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 da, yum, yum. La da da da, yum.
Oh!
Don Giovanni, you got visiting again, huh?
We found him wandering along the road.
Lucy, Kate, this is my brother, Rick.
Your brother?
Yeah.
Well, there's no way I'll be quitting. I wouldn't believe they're not that set up before this came in.
Do you realize what this means? We're all alone here.
I don't know what you're going to say.
There's a certain lack of realism on his part.
Pull her up!
And you know what I'm going to do next? I'm going to get all the junk, stick it down the barrel of a big cannon, and fire it at the canvas.
Now, you're a man of the right caliber threat.
Right caliber?
Well, not bad, eh?
It was okay, but if I have to wear this again, you can find yourself another jockey.
Well, it was 200 of them.
And another 19 boxes.
What? That's whole house. Whole house and toilet. Get it out. Get it out. I've got to get it out. Out. Move. Pick up your feet and move. Out, 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 out. Come along. Come along. What a move on.
Thanks for the ride, Rudy.
Good evening, everyone. Welcome to Galloway Park.
Hello, how nice to see you.
And ladies and gentlemen, the Prime Minister of Australia, Mr. Bob Hawke.
Who did that Richmond Airbase? And he had all these guys running around in Secret Service outfits with, you know, guns and stuff, which was pretty bizarre. I mean, he had, like, you know, eight personal bodyguard type things and then other people running around.
About half an hour before he arrived, Secret Service men came and the police sort of thing, and all the coppers knew who I was, but the Secret Service men didn't know who Frank was, so they had to find out. And they finally found out, oh, he's the one, that one there, he looks the same as the others, you know, all the stripes and everything on, the gun belt and all that. And they sidled up to me, and they were rather nervous, very edgy, because there was sort of the Australian Secret Service people to protect Bob, so to speak. And they started to mutter and talk to me, and then all of a sudden said, of course, your gun's not loaded, is it? You don't have anything, not even blanks in it, do you? And I whipped it out and said, this. And, of course, it was only a butt made of Bakelite or plastic or something. There was no barrel at all. They heaved a great sigh of relief. So they backed off like that straight away when I whipped the gun out. So, of course, it was only a butt.
Coming up next, I've found some never-before-seen goose to show you. That's a few other funny surprises. Is the equivalent of making a movie in 7 days. That means hard work and long days. But the heavy workload doesn't stop everyone having fun. They like playing practical jokes on each other. Jokes like these.
I remember one scene where the entire crew and cast seemed to be in on this practical joke about me. It was when I came back again after being off when I first returned to be a regular. And we had to do these scenes with Gordon Parker, and Joe Lutter was the plumber apprentice there for a while. And we had to dig this sewer, and in the scene, the sewage was supposed to come up and go in my face. And I thought, oh, you know, they'll do something that won't be a real sewer, of course. And I mentioned it to the floor manager at the time, I think it was. I just said, oh, what's happening about the, you know, stuff that comes out the pipe? And he said, oh, well, we've got this really great location where the guys don't mind if we tap into their system.
Well, there we go.
What? And it's going to be, you know, real. Who are you coming at me? And it was like, no, this one made me so scared that I was going to have this stuff coming at me into my face, you know, and I'd have to remember to keep my mouth shut.
But it smells! All right.
I went into the scene thinking, this is going to be real. This is, I'm going to, like, get hepatitis from this. This is going to be awful. I can't stand it. And it turned out that they'd put just clay and water together, and they all laughed at me afterwards because I was so upset.
We were working with a director that we knew very well with that, and Rob Sanders, who's been a vet assistant and country practice for many years, helping us get the technicalities of things right. Otherwise, you get, you know, people that are vets at home that, that's not real, that's not the way you do it or something. So we try and make sure that it's as realistic as possible, as with all the medical stuff. And Rob had brought in this head, and we had the real dog as well, which we'd done all the location shooting with and all that kind of thing, and it was a gorgeous dog. And, you know, of course we didn't want to have to anesthetize about the dog if it wasn't necessary. So Rob said, oh, well, use this head. From one of those shops where they just, you know, had stuffed animals. And so we had all these sandbags underneath and the dog's head, but and very few people had been around in the studio when we'd actually set it up. So most people thought that it was just a dog under anaesthetic. We were doing the final test and we decided that, you know, before we went for it, we'd just keep rolling at the end of this and pull out the head. Come on! It was very, very funny.
Occasionally things really do go wrong on the set.
I've found some goofs from over the years. Here they are.
Comes from the working, does it?
Yeah, I suppose.
It's probably some sort of plant in the park.
Oh, that's great. See, I told you nothing would
go
wrong. I'm just going to leave it.
Fluff up, sometimes. It's only five take, because it used to take me five takes to get a scene.
Yeah, but I love the way she can't do things.
Mind you, there's not so many things she can't do, but when she can and I can't, well, she can't and I can.
George.
Hey, there's a hand here.
Who's the ambulance for this one? Will you be all right here?
You see the thing.
It's hard to get out of that hurry, though. Because in normal situations, you've trained for years to do that sort of stuff.
With wounded nose on, running the major state, one must show the flag.
Well, it's a matter of patriotism. I better put mine on the nose.
This is a comfortable thing. I do that a lot, and spoonerism.
I've never thrown a pizza in my life. You did it over and over and over again. It hit the boom, it hit the camera, it got stuck up in the rifle somewhere. It went everywhere, but it got down to earth.
So,
you look dreadful.
Oh, thank you. Thank you very much.
I'm tired.
I know exactly what you mean. I feel dreadful. There's nothing I'd like more right now than to get straight upstairs and collapse in an undignified heap. Being a shearer on an axe from Jack doesn't sit there and partner.
Not only props that get in the way, medical tongue twisters can also trip them after up.
It's a routine transurethral resection of the prostate. We remove the tissue with a little gadget called a receptoscope. It's a receptoscope. I put a lot of time in it. It's one of the rules of the adages about acting. I think naturalistic acting is get the job right.
We'll have to do an exploratory thoracotomy.
We've got to find out where this bleeding's coming from. We did actually go into hospitals, we're allowed into watch operations. It's fascinating. Some of the other actors have been, and doctors have been carried out of operating theatres. But I really enjoyed it. And I always carried around two books with an old nursing dictionary of my mother's that she had just after the war when she was still working as a nurse. And that holds pronunciations of the more common terms. It didn't help with all the modern drugs, of course, but a lot of the other stuff. It had definitions. We also had a medical encyclopedia. I wasn't sure about anything, just looked it up.
Getting it right is also important to actors portraying police.
You're a hard person to find, Miss Watson. When the character was presented to me, it was a different character than what I finished up playing anyway. They'd based him on some policeman they knew. I decided to make him a different type of character, so I didn't smoke, I didn't drink. Orange juice became popular when Frank came on the screen.
What are you doing? You might need it.
The day my job requires me to shoot a 12-year-old boy, that's the day I don't want to know anymore.
Frank, are you sure that's a good idea?
I'd rather the boy shoot me. I just wanted to get to children, you know, and it worked because still today the little kids are the ones that come up to me all the time, more so than the middle-aged people. Want to talk about it?
Wandon Valley have always been popular. Next up, romantic highlights and behind-the-scenes secrets.
It was fun. It was fabulous fun.
Finis and Joy, as popular characters have taken the plunge. A few of the actors to share their memories of their wedding day.
It's time to commence the service.
The Fondenberry's first wedding was that of Frank and Shirley.
But yeah, that was a fun time wedding, and it was an outdoor wedding in the garden.
Frank and Shirley have decided to get married, and they've asked me to perform the ceremony.
And it rained. Well, it didn't rain on the day. They had to make rain.
Oh.
I think we should go inside.
Hey, your fire hose can really, you know, gush out a lot of water. So we went sliding, you know, fleeing into the house, and in the house at that time there was a snake loose.
Ah! The snake!
On the shelves over there. Well, it's not there now.
Ah! Snake!
Ah! Well, that was the first time, I think, that Penny had to pick up a big snake.
Come on, Samantha. You weren't invited to this wedding.
And she was very brave. I never could have done it.
The most watched of all weddings is that of Vicky the Vet and Dr. Simon Bowen.
So many people thought I was still dummy on the back of a truck. I really was on the back of his truck with Brian Wendell driving it, going faster and faster and faster, and laughing like crazy. But I kept screaming abusive language, I might add, at Brian Wendell saying slow down, and the director was going faster, faster, and it was fun. It was fabulous fun.
But it was a long day, and actually, we rarely filmed at night with the country practice.
Mm. It was really hot, and little Emily Nicole.
Yes.
Gosh, she had such a long day, too.
Yes.
She'd fall asleep and then wake up to be a little flower girl and fall asleep again.
I pronounce them husband and wife in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. You may kiss the bride.
It was filmed in a little church in Pitt Town with the real pastor of that church.
He also was an extra.
Well, I played the minister, and he was actually a minister, and I asked him, are we actually married?
The most dramatic of all the weddings was that of Harry and Kate.
No, it's not. It was a beautiful wedding.
I think it was
one of the highlights of playing Kate. It was one of the really high moments. We had a great day. Dramatic storylines, everything goes wrong.
First of all, we had a balloon that bounced.
We're miles from the church, we're already late.
Being the rider that he is, and the cowboy, a bit of a boy, he spies a horse standing there by itself in the middle of the paddock. Just happens to have a halter in the balloon. But smooth and silky, whatever the material is they use. And when you're on bareback, it's very, very hard to hang on. So this horse on this particular day was all over the place. And as a result, I had sores in my bum and I couldn't walk for about 3 days afterwards. And I'd never had that in the whole 10, 15 years previous that I'd been riding.
Have always been a large part of life in Wandon Valley, and over the years we've shared the joy new life can bring. None was more dramatic than the unexpected arrival of Simon and Vicky's twins in a barn. As Penny Cook and Grant Dobble recall, it was a day full of drama.
Giving birth was fairly extraordinary because we were having twins, and for many reasons it was extraordinary because but having pregnancy padding for a long period of time was one thing. But then we got out to location,
and I was supposed to be out there giving birth in a barn, being helped by another vet. And in fact, the actor, who is my step-uncle in real life, was very ill, so we'd shot half the week, and then he couldn't turn up for the proper stuff. So then in those days, no mobile phones or anything, and they had to run down to Windsor to ring Grant and Shane Livingston and say, quickly, quickly, come out to location.
Vicky!
Brendan, I'm here! The baby's coming!
Yes, of course the baby's coming. You don't want to be size 22 forever, do you?
We're improvising away on location until they arrive, and then we get there. And the boys, can we improvise that, virtually the whole episode, around what was written, with the boys doing it. And at that stage, also, a lot of people on the crew had babies, and everybody was saying, well, no, when my wife did it, she did it this way. Well, my wife did it, no, it was this way.
Darling, we can't have our babies in a barn.
It's too late.
Huh?
It's a girl.
They came in singing Ghostbusters. They were so chuffed at coming to save the day.
It's a boy. Oh. You've got a beautiful baby boy. That's it. Oh, I've got a boy. I've got a boy and a girl.
Shane spent three quarters of the day with his hands up my dress. It was just the oddest.
And when Chloe was born, I actually went to the birth of a baby. We actually filmed the birth of a baby. Can't do that these days with the child welfare regulations.
Was a head. Nice, little, round head.
Oh, I've got a
breath. Another little one now, Molly. Just a gentle one. Easy.
For the next 4 years, Australia watched and delighted as Chloe grew from a newborn baby into a lovable little girl.
Yes, I remember bits and pieces. I was usually scared. I remember some other things. I was eating.
Baby, we're not the best, aren't you, darling?
How's my big girl going?
My Uncle Bob always used to pick me up and give me a big hug. That's why I need to rest about him.
Oh, nice green nose. That's lovely, darling.
Ah.
Am I going to be a Martian?
Oh, I don't know what a Martian says, but it's fine.
I just remember pain. Just give me the pain from the pain in your faces.
Because you and I are going to have some fun today. Is that right?
Yes.
Put your arm in. Sweetheart, I know we haven't seen a lot of each other lately. That's because Daddy's been, well, not feeling too well.
I'm like a baby sister.
You can't have a baby sister.
I remember
how
different it was when Chloe died. It was a bit strange and true.
Yeah.
Just
standing with little baby tomatoes. So you can grow us some tomatoes for tea. You'd like that, wouldn't you?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yes, I remember too, Dad. I remember old flying cat. Who's Brendan?
More wind. You blow. Blow.
I knew a couple of girls who work in a restaurant. And their boss never watched television. He was just interested in his business. And the night Molly died, nobody went to restaurants until about 9:30 at night. And they couldn't understand it. And the girls told the boss, they said, well, Molly dies tonight. I said, who's Molly? What is she dying tonight for? So they go, well, it's as serious as he's never heard of it. But that's the effect our show has had on the public. They wouldn't miss that episode of Molly where she passed on. Thank you.
Shirley's death had such an impact on viewers that when it came time for Shirley to meet an unhappy end, Lorraine Desmond was determined her death would be heard and not seen.
I had a lot of letters from children over the years, and one I'll never forget because this lady phoned me, rang the studio and then got in touch. Apparently, Shirley had been hurt in a car crash, not seriously, but her daughter wouldn't sleep and cried all night and was quite hysterical. So I actually had to phone and say, look, I'm all right, I was just playing pretend, it's not real, you know. And I thought, well, why do that to kids? If you can just not be, if it's not seen, and they suddenly say, oh, she's dead, or gone, then to me that was a cleaner way of doing it.
Frank. She's dead. I'm so sorry, mate. The way it was great to work with, you know, we had a lot of fun. And of course I had the scenes following her death, which were very good for me, and allowed me to cry, so I think.
The death of his wife in the show had an eerie similarity to that of his real wife, who died just a couple of years earlier.
The office ran the, Lynn Bahamas was the producer in those days, the creative producer, and she rang and said, how would you feel about your wife in the show, Daisy, dying? Because Daisy was never featured at all, only spoken about up to that point, and dying of cancer, similar to your own wife. Well, my wife had only been dead about 2 years, 8 months, 2 years, of the same type of cancer. Well, I said, well, let me think about it for a moment. What do you want to do this? You know, I said, well, we're writing it. We want to write it now. And I said, well, okay, let me think about it. And I'll ring you back in 10 minutes. So I sat down, and I did really think, could I do it? Because I was still very much affected by it after a couple of years. We were very close, my wife and I. And I went back and I said, look, I'll do it. But and it was a bit of a dedication to my wife, too, you know, sort of a, and it was a cut-off point.
And the book you bought for me.
When my wife died, my real wife, I walked out of the hospital after that had happened. And there were two young nurses walking into the hospital, going to work, and I sort of wanted to say, well, don't go in there, my wife's in there. Now, in the show, they had me walking away from the hospital in the same situation, unbeknownst that it really happened. Two nurses are walking in to that hospital, in the Valley Hospital. So I turned, and I put my hand up, and just stopped them going in. And I never realized I did that until I saw that episode back. Now, that was for real. I really felt bad. At that moment.
Coming up next, cast members reveal how they make dancing, driving, and riding look easy. For a musical evening, Wongan Valley was the venue for many shows that featured the talents of the locals.
Ladies and gentlemen, I'm the great Benanini, master of the unknown.
Now, blossom in the springtime. We like to gamble in the big room, to be the nation face to face.
The writers periodically would decide that they had to have a concert, and I used to live in dread of these concerts coming up because I knew they'd probably, somebody would write me in to sing, and of course to me, the singer in the family, you know, in the Gilroy family, was Frank. You know, he belonged to the local musical society, and he was the singer. And Cheryl was a receptionist, nurse, and a mum, and she wasn't a singer. And I didn't want to sing in the show because I felt that my other life, my real life, which is music. You know, I didn't want that to get lost in Wonder Valley. And I didn't want to have to try and learn how to sing like a country nurse when the rest of my life I've been singing like a cabaret performer or a musical comedy person or something. You know? So to get out of this, I try to find ways of making it funny.
In the stop shoe, I have the stop shoe. A one, a two, a doodly doodly doo.
And then it came up. The idea that Vicky and Shirley do a number together, I came up with the idea of the sand dance and dressing us up like, you know,
Trance. In the olden days, just like a portable team, Doc, she was the rain, you were my favorite queen.
And for the sound for the sand dance, using Kitty Litter. Because Vicky did a bitch, you see. It wasn't really Kitty Litter. So don't try, it wouldn't work.
Give me the Doc, shoe, I said the a one, a two, a doodly doodly doo.
She kept laughing at me.
No, she was sweet. She found the song and everything and gave and was absolutely sweet as pie about
it. And of course with Matron Sloan and Cheryl doing the Indian Love Call, I keep trying to find things that were insane and ridiculous that would hide the fact that I didn't want to sing.
When I was a girl, and you were up on my lap to you, to be around. I'm waiting all alone. And if you should see that I'm crying when it's near, and I hear a humming echo from here, then
not only were the cast asked to sing and dance, they also extended their talents to some very dramatic stunts. They cheated.
Beer can't play golf to save my life. I had a double first up.
Yeah.
I remember friends saying, mate, you hit that ball. Did you see it go? You know, and I'm like, yeah. I did. Was it you? No. You know. But I've developed a few skills with the clubs, but certainly not the same as my riding. I grew up as a, you know, on a little bit of acreage, and we were into horses as kids, and right up through adolescence to leaving home, and that's been wonderful for the show, for myself, you know, as well, because it's something that I can bring to it. Please let me ride. Give me a horse to ride. Oh yeah, but actors say they can do anything. I'll show you. You know, so they gave me a horse to ride, and they said, well, you can do this. Yeah, so they wrote some more of that in it.
One more clue around and a couple of
things. More important than Richie Wolf on Camp Baby.
Oh, you're doing well.
Richie's money doesn't work. Now do it. Keep the wet books out of his cleanup now.
Always somebody breaks their leg or gets a collapsed lung somewhere or has a baby on a mountain or something goes on somewhere, you know.
Good one, good one.
Don't say, mate.
Wait, what's it doing?
I went away to a country farm to an old mate of mine, Desi Kushler,
I stayed there. Learned to ride a horse.
Cookie, now you've got to get a horse started before you worry about how to stop him.
Well, just practicing.
Cape down, you get...
Now, I like it up here.
Steve can only keep Bob and Esme busy for so long. This is a crash course.
Crash? Don't use that word.
Time to get acquainted.
Now, well, I'm not ready.
Of course you are.
Now, look, Kate.
The only job I got to ride a horse with was a jockey who couldn't ride.
Sometimes seems for the actors to take the plunge.
Well, I suppose the one that comes to mind most is where I had to be chased by a fierce Alsatian.
Nice doggy.
And then they said, oh, no, it's much better if you fall in backwards. So I said, no, you'll catch me, won't you? And when I came up again, I got this insane desire for hysterical laughter. And, of course, I was supposed to look terrified because of the dog, so I had to sort of try and change this facial expression because I thought I don't have to do this again.
That day, he tried his hand at some fancy driving.
I remember doing a 360 in a car and not expecting to. We were going at 70, and we had a stunt guy, Grant Page, in the back seat with a rope tied around the handbrake. And he said, just drive to about 70, and then I'll pull the handbrake on, but don't brake. Just turn the wheel slightly when I pull the handbrake on. And I expected to go into a slide or something. We're meant to be avoiding a car. It was kind of on. And so he pulled it, and I turned it slightly, and he just did this whole 360 all the way around.
Come on, you moron!
For Grant Dodwell, the ultimate driving experience was a high-powered sports car.
Now I ask you, is this not a Casper Jump?
The Ferrari was Jeffrey Edelston's, who had he hired his car out and his house for various productions over the time. And I'll never forget it because it had one of the first mobile phones in it. And they had to cover the number plate too. It said Spunky, which wasn't really a country practice. So I don't know what they made it. Hunky, I think they made it, yeah. And nevertheless, I remember thinking, I've never driven a Ferrari before. And they said, well, Grant, you just go down there and turn around and come back again. I went, yeah, okay. for another take. And, of course, I went off for a little trip. And I could hear the first assistant going, Dodwell, bring back that Ferrari. As I was driving along, ringing up a friend saying, guess where I am? I'm driving Jeff Edelston's Ferrari.
Coming up after the break, actors recall the joys and problems of working with four-legged co-stars.
Run. A learned colleague and comrade in arms, Fatso.
Oh, Fatso, you dear Fatso, aren't you gorgeous? Now,
the nips. I mean, that was the
nips.
People would say to me, how many, what's Fatso doing now? They ask what I'm doing, I'm going to jump on the wombat's doing. And I said, well, he's still got the limousine franchise. But what the hell?
Many of the animals used in a country practice were Australian wildlife, tame hand.
And they're all going like this, and we just had to finish the scene. Oh, it was revolting.
Kate Raisin, who played a park ranger, shared many scenes with cute and cuddly animals. But Kate's most fearsome co-star was a full-grown lion.
The vet at the time, Nick Vaffalo, had to get in the cage with the lion. And what I remember about it most was the lion was sedated. He had to get in the cage. I had to stand at the door of the cage. And the vet who had sedated the lion was there with a gun. Basically, in case the lion came to. So I remember the vet. It was a tranquilizing gun, but it looked like a revolver to actually be standing just out of shot in case the lion woke up.
Wasn't too bad with the snake. I've been bitten by a chimpanzee, scratched on the nose with a koala. I went and got a tetanus shot when I did the koala bit. And then the actual bite from the chimp came later, so I went back to the doctor and said, I was bitten by a chimpanzee, and the expression on his face is...
Dr. Tyler!
Yes, Miss Watson.
I'm sorry to interrupt. I've brought you a patient.
I've been brought up. She was a day old when they rescued her. I think it was the daughter of one of the circus families. Brought her up as a pet.
You're not going to believe what Esme's got here.
Lady whose pet it was, she said, oh, you can hold her as firmly as you like. So of course, I really held her by the wrists, and she went and bit into my hand. So and then we therefore had to rewrite the thing, and I did all my lines talking to this, focused on me talking to Holly.
We've related, you know. Not in the direct sense, not the immediate family sense. We are related to Mr. Darwin.
And then they did scenes of Holly just sitting eating apples and things, which she quite happily did, but we couldn't hold her. No one could hold her.
Farm stock can be a problem, as with this camera-shy calf. But from that day, the arrival of a newborn calf was an unforgettable experience.
We once helped a cow give birth by using chains. Actually, we had to do it. We were going to fake it, but we had to skip dessert because the cow broke its water right after lunch. And, I couldn't do it.
Yeah, that's right. Okay. Here she comes, looking good.
We had chains. The vet actually placed chains inside the cow into the hooves of the calf. And we had to pull these chains for about 20 minutes until it finally flew out. And then I just had two cameras and they just kept rolling, so we actually did everything for real. That was pretty amazing.
There we go.
After we go, we're going to dessert, and we go, no, it's fine.
Come on, Charlie, be a good girl.
When it came to domestic animals, family pets formed a special bond with their human co-stars.
Well, actually, it was Gordon Parker's Ben White stock. At the time.
Charlie.
And that dog would do, it was the best dog, I'm supposed to say. It was a dog that would do anything you wanted. It would walk. I actually built up a very special relationship with that, so I loved that dog. It would sit in a scene and not move, and you could do whatever you wanted around it. And it would just sit there going, I'm a dog. I'm here. You know, it was great.
I said to them at some stage, look, I'd like him to have a pet. I'd like him to have a cat. So we did. We got a cat, which is quite wonderful.
You are to provide me with company and entertainment. You catch the odd mouse, you keep yourself clean, you stay away from the filing cabin. Me, on the other hand, in return, I give you comfort and security, regular meals, regular grooming.
The cat's name is Cheerio in real life, and this cat would be the Robert De Niro of animals. He knows where his mark is.
Okay, don't you get any ideas? You touch that fish, I'll catch him.
He's absolutely wonderful.
I'm sorry.
But nothing can compare to tackling a belligerent, mud-covered cow.
Flippin' cow!
The cow, we're driving along in this, in the MG, driving along, going to Burrigan. It was sort of like our first big date.
Can you hear that?
What?
It's a cow.
What is?
That bleating.
That's what cows normally do, Vicky.
Simon, turn it off.
We've got to
help it.
I asked him to put my hair in a waffle oven so that it all went straight down the side.
And I was in the tuxedo and we're driving along and it was a classic thing. Vicky going, the cow, it's in distress. And I went, yes, so what? We're going to do that.
Vicky, what are you doing?
If we take our clothes off, we needn't get any muck on them.
Vicky, get your gear off, Simon.
I remember it was very late afternoon.
Yeah, the cow kept running away. And so we had to keep going for another take.
And literally fell into the mud.
Where the cow had been doing a bit of business.
But it was so tight. It was like, come on, guys. I've got to get this. Light's fading. We've only got 3 minutes. Come on.
Oh! Something slithered around me. Oh, there you go. Go, you silly old cow.
Get me out. There are things in here.
I said, my skin, cool. And it was mosquito larvae.
And they had to drive us down to the Hawkesbury River to just wash it off.
But there we were in the Hawkesbury going, oh, this is a great glamorous business, isn't it? Yeah. I was a regular. Oh, no, it's a tumbler.
With one of the crew, Ian Morphy, sitting in the truck, couldn't believe that the two of us just took all our clothes off and just jumped into the water. And he's just like this going, I can't believe the two of us just found
Well, that's it. It's over. I'm sure you've enjoyed tonight's celebration as much as I have. It's been a real pleasure bringing this very special event to you, the fans who've loved the country practice for all these years. Goodbye.